turn to you, Professor Milton Friedman.
Here's Milton Friedman winning the Nobel Prize and getting booed, jeered at the ceremony. Why would an advocate of freedom make someone so angry? Well, a lot of people don't like Milton Friedman's ideas, and with us now is a college professor who's the author of the book Consumed, How Markets Corrupt Children, Infantilize Adults, Swallow Citizens Whole. So please welcome Ben Barber. You teach courses at the University of Maryland, and you are a senior fellow at the liberal think tank Demos.
So
what did he get wrong? I think he got it all right.
Well, what he got wrong and what you all have gotten wrong today on the show is the notion that the choice we face is between a free, competitive, small business marketplace and a big, bad, bureaucratic government. And if that were the choice, I'd be with Milton Friedman. But the real choice we face is between big, untransparent corporations, which are much bigger in many cases than government in terms of what it does, and democratic government, which belongs to us. You don't like what happens in government, you vote them out. You don't like what happens at BP, who do you vote for? You just watch the world get polluted.
But government you get to vote for every 4 years. I get to decide if I don't like BP every day. I can choose not to go there.
You can choose. Yeah, you can choose whether you want BP or Shell or Mobile. But if you want light rail transport in the United States that's electrified, you don't even have that choice because we have taken off the table the significant public choices that constitute real choice and are made to think that because you can choose between 200 kinds of car, from a Hummer to a Prius, that makes freedom. You go to L.A., there's no public transportation to use. To me, those are fundamental human choices that have been taken off the table in a purely market economy, in a balance between a democratic and a market economy. That works. When you have unbridled capitalism, which again in the last 30 years we've had here, you've got lots of problems. Just look in the Gulf of Mexico if you want to see one of them.
We've had unbridled capitalism. We had that big pile of rules. They look like bridles to me.
Well, one of those bridled rules has to do with drilling and so on, and we've seen that the regulations that were in place were not sufficient to stop BP.
More regulations might have.
Yes, had they been required, for example, to dig in advance the two relief holes that are now being dug and that may come into play in August, they would have been ready had there been a catastrophe. That would have doubled their drilling costs, interfered with stakeholder costs, and as a result, the public interests of Louisiana, the U.S., and the world were put at risk so stakeholder profits could be increased. That's the difference, public goods versus private goods.
And if every well had to have two relief holes, wouldn't that make gas cost $5 a gallon?
It sure would, and maybe we'd use less and we'd go to alternative energy, and then we'd be in a good situation.
Without regulation, companies would underpay their workers.
They would indeed, and they have in the past. When capitalism in the 19th century got started in England and here, they paid much less than a living wage. 12-year-olds worked 12 to 15 hours a day instead of going to school. And they did it, again, not because they wanted to abuse children, but because they wanted to maximize profits.
So we need minimum wage laws, child wage laws, OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, to keep the workers safe.
Indeed, started by that great socialist president, Richard Nixon, who was at the time the president when OSHA, Office of Safety and Health Administration, was put in. Just like Teddy Roosevelt, another great Republican, was the first one to pass antitrust legislation to prevent private so-called competitive corporations from becoming big monopolies.
And let me just clarify this graph which we put up, which supports your point about OSHA. It does show that workplace deaths have dropped steadily since OSHA was created in 1971.
Well, we need the government, we need our democratic institutions. It's not some big backer, it's ours. We need our public interest organizations to ensure that things like good water, safety of children, good education for children, no salt and sugar in the foods of children, smoking, drugs, that those things are contained. There's no reason for corporations to do it. I don't think they should do it, but it, our public interest organizations, our democratic organization, the state, belongs to us. You keep saying, folks here keep saying, the state, like it's dropped in from Mars, like we're in the Soviet Union. The state belongs to us. We vote for the governor, the mayor, the city council, the Congress. We may not like them, but then it's our fault. Vote for the ones you do like. And the Tea Party's got it right. If they don't like the way it's doing, vote for it. But the Tea Party cannot vote for the Board of Governors of BP. They can vote for the U.S. Congress. And that's the difference between government, which belongs to us, and corporations, which don't.
Got some support in the audience.
Thank you, folks, for that minority.
Let me just make a point about OSHA. I mean, while that OSHA chart is impressive, look at this next chart, because somebody then went back and charted how workplace deaths had dropped steadily before OSHA was created. The slope of the line is exactly the same. OSHA made no difference. In a free society, things get better on their own.
But that's just not true. They really don't. We're not going to get into a technical discussion here, but go back to the 19th century. I mean, who here who's clapping wants their 12-year-olds to work for a buck an hour?
But it would have gone away
anyway. You don't want that.
You know,
we don't have to deal with that. It's happening in Mexico today. It's happening in Indonesia today. 12-year-olds work. That's why we get the cheap goods from Mexico and Indonesia. Because here we don't employ kids, there they do. That makes their goods competitive with us. They can produce cheap goods because there's no safety standards, because there's no environmental standards, because they hire young children, and there's no minimum wage.